Hi guys, welcome to this video. In this tutorial, we are going to build a Bitcoin wallet using the blockchain technology and Django. Users are going to be able to send and receive Bitcoin in the wallet. They are going to be able to access their private key. It's going to be a fun series. If you guys like more tutorials like this, please don't forget to subscribe to my channel at Code with Tommy. Having that said, now let's dive straight into the tutorial.
Okay, so let's look at the project demo. I'm going to show you guys what the finished product of the Bitcoin wallet will look like, and then we are going to set up our project with Django, and then we are going to design our front end. We are going to use Bootstrap, and I'm going to leave all the code to the front end and the back end, the old source code, in my GitHub. I'm going to leave the link in the description below, and then we are going to create a Bitcoin wallet for a user. That means we are going to create a wallet and a private key. And then we are going to apply user authentication, which is going to cover up the login and sign up. And then we are going to apply our Django admin interface. This will allow us to maintain our site from an admin interface, which is provided to us by Django. And then we are going to write a code which will allow us to get the wallet address details. This means we'll be able to know the balance which is in a user's wallet address and the amount of time they have done his transactions. And then we are going to get the QR code of a Bitcoin wallet address. This QR code is used in receiving Bitcoins. And then we are going to allow user to send and receive Bitcoin. That's all for the agenda of this course. Let's go straight into the course. Okay guys, this is a demo of the project. This is what the finished project looks like. It's just a simple site to show you details about the site. And when a user clicks on register, the user is redirected to the register page. This is where the user will fill in details to register. Once the user is registered successfully, will be redirected to the login page. Then once the user can log in, will be redirected to his dashboard. In here, the user will see his Bitcoin wallet. And then I added a feature which allows the user to click on submit before you can see the details of the wallet due to security reasons. Now once the user clicks on submit, the user will now be redirected back to the dashboard, but now with the details of his wallet. Now it says that he has 0 USD in his wallet, 0 Bitcoin, 0 received, 0 sent, the final balance is 0. And I also added a feature which allows the user to see his balance in Bitcoin and in US dollars. To see this, final balance, as you can see, is 0 Bitcoin, 0 USD. Transaction, 0 number of transaction. That means the user has not done any transaction. And I also added an admin interface, meaning you can maintain your site from the admin dashboard. Let's head over there to see it. Now, once you go to ping/admin, you'll be able to log in as an admin and then maintain the site from here. But nobody is able to log in for now because this is my site. But when you are done with yours, your finished project, you'll be able to log in to maintain your site. When you click on users, you'll be able to see the amount of users and their details. But I'm not going to click on that now for security reasons. But this is what our project looks like. I hope you enjoy the series. Thank you. Okay, so guys, we're going to be setting up our project with Django. To do that, it's very easy. Let's just head over to our desktop. And then we're going to type Django admin start project. And we're going to name it Bitcoin wallet. Now it has created a Django project called Bitcoin wallet. And now let's head over into that project. Now to make sure that everything did, let's just press ls. Once we see manage.py, that means it has successfully started the project. To run the project, to cross check if everything did, type python 3 manage.py run server. Now you see that it's successfully running on the localhost. Now let's test it out.
so that we just come here and paste that local URL. And then we see that it says your installation worked successfully. Congratulations. Now we have successfully set up our project. In the next part, we are going to be designing the front end. Okay guys, since our project is now running successfully, let's go ahead to design the front end. To do that, we are going to import our project into Visual Studio Code. Let's head over to Visual Studio Code. Let's first quit this terminal. We don't need it again. We're going to close that. And then in Visual Studio Code, we're going to open a folder. And the folder we're going to open is our project, which is Bitcoin Wallet. This is it. We'll click on Open. And this is going to open our project. And then we can code and edit our project from this IDE. Now to specify and to design the front end, we need to create two folders, which are static and templates. So to do that, I'll just type static, and then we're going to create another folder called templates. Okay, we made a mistake, we created a folder under static, so let's just delete that. Delete. Move to trash. So in the root directory, we're going to create another folder called templates. Now we have the two folders we need, static and templates. Now the next thing we need to do is to specify the static and templates. Note, before you can follow along with this tutorial, you need to have some basic knowledge of Django. So first of all, let me make this a little large. So let's head over to the settings.py file. Now in the settings.py file, we're going to scroll down and look for the templates dictionary. And inside there, we're going to look for theirs. In here, we're going to type os.path.join. And then we're going to open the brackets and type base there. I'm going to write a comma and I'm going to write templates. What this does is that we tell Django where our templates folder is located. That means in the base directory, as in the roots directory, in templates. And the next thing we need to do now is to go to the end and just type this code in. Note, I'm going to leave the whole source code of this tutorial. I'm going to post it on my GitHub and I'm going to leave the link in the description below. So if you guys have any problem or any error along the way, you can just follow along and just tap in from the source code. Now we've specified the static and the template files. Now I have designed the front end to be Django modified. We don't need to design the front end from scratch. I already have the front end designed. So I'm also going to leave the link in my GitHub in the source code. The front end is going to be there. So to get that, we're just going to head over here. I have it in my game wallet folder. So the template folder, I'm going to copy everything there. And we're just going to go to Visual Studio Code and paste it into templates. Now you see we have that in templates, and we also want to paste the static. So we're going to come here and then copy everything in static. And then when we're done selecting all this, we're going to head over to Visual Studio Code. And then in Visual Studio Code, we're going to paste it. Okay, I don't know what's going on. It's not heading over. Let's give it another try. Now we're going to paste it in static here. I'm going to say copy folders. Now, having that done, we're going to move over to the URL mapping. In Django, there's something they call URL mapping, which allows Django to know where to go when a user visits a specific URL. To do that, we are going to create an app. We're going to create a Django app. Now, first, let's open a new terminal. And in this place, let's press ls to make sure we're in the right directory. And then let's create a new app. To do that, we say Django admin start app. Let's just name it wallets. Now you see it right here, it has created a new app called Wallet. Before we do anything, let's head over to the settings file and add that app to the installed apps. Let's see Wallet. Having that done, we are good to go. It's time for the URL mapping. We can close the settings.py file now. And actually want to make one adjustment. Okay, I think that's done. So in the Wallet app, this is the Wallet app right here. What we need to do now is to create a new URLs.py file. Create a file called URLs.py. And then we're going to head over to this place. You guys should just follow me along so you get all the explanations I'm doing and all the code. And if you have any error or any problem, once again, you can drop it in the comments or send me an email or message me on Twitter at TonyTokoTree. I'm going to answer all questions. And if you don't feel like messaging me, you can check out the source code to compare it with your code to check out for your bugs or errors. Now we're going to open the second URL, the PY file. And we're going to import this from django.urls import path. From django.urls import path. Now we need this path to specify the URLs. So we're just going to come here also and just copy this to save time. Now we're going to say when a user goes to a blank directory, that means when the user comes to the site, it should give us views.index and the name is equal to index. Now this should do the work, but we should also need to come to the views file, and then now we're going to create our view function, which is going to allow us to render the HTML page. To do that, I'm going to say there index request, and then we're going to put a column. I'm going to say return render request, and I'm going to give it the HTML page, which is index.html. I'm going to save this. Now when we run our app, automatically we should have a design front end page loaded. So let's just head over back to the terminal below here. Let me make that big a little. Okay, I think this would be, this is maximized enough. So let's type python 3 manage.py run server. Okay, it gives us an error. It says no module name found for Let's Django. So let's head over to settings. Settings.py, this is where the error is coming from. We forgot to add a comma. Please be very careful with Python or Django. A little mistake can give you a buggy error. Now, after having that fixed, you see that this is done. Now, when we go over here and refresh this page, it doesn't show us the page we need. And why is that? That's because we only specify the home page for the URLs of the app. But we also need to go to the URL of the whole project to specify the home page. And for that, we're going to need to import include. And we're going to say path. This means when someone goes to the home directory, we should include wallets.urls. We should do this. And then we should give it a comma. When we run this again, it should give us, now it says error, name views.index is not defined. Yeah, we know we're going to have a lot of errors by the way. So let's get there and see. It says name views is not defined. And now this is because we didn't import views. So we say from this directory, import views. Now, when we come here to refresh, now you guys see this is the front end. We've not optimized it well, but as we go on in the tutorial, we're going to do everything very well. Okay, so guys, since we have our project running now, the front end is good now, I want to show you guys how to create a Bitcoin wallet with Python. This is the technique we are going to be using to create the Bitcoin wallet for users that sign up with our site. So we are not going to enter Visual Studio Code for now. We are going to open our terminal. I just want to show you guys how this is done. Now let me enlarge this. I'm just going to enter my Python 3 shell, and then I'm going to import a Python library called Bitcoin. So before I proceed, you must have a Python library called Bitcoin installed on your machine. To do that, just type pip3 install Bitcoin. If you're on your Windows, just type pip install Bitcoin. That will do the work. If you have it installed already, let's go on and type from Bitcoin import all. Now this will import all the function and everything we need to create private key Bitcoin wallet and public key. Now to create a private key, let's give it a variable called private key. I'm just going to use the random key function. Now when we print private key, you see that this gives us a random Bitcoin private key. Now I'm going to convert this private key into a public key. To do that, it's very simple. We're just going to say public key is equals to priv to pub private key. That means we are converting the private key to a public key. So now when we print out this public key, you see, it gives us a Bitcoin public key. Now this public key is what we're going to use to convert it to a wallet address. To do that, let's say address equals to pub to ADDR, and we're going to give it the public key, which is public key. Public key. Now when we print out address, you see that we have a Bitcoin wallet address. Now in with this Bitcoin address, you can send funds into the address, and with this private key, you can send funds out of the address. That means you can access the private key. And notes, do not close this window until you have your private key. If not, any funds that you send into this wallet address is gone. You only need your private key to access it. So this is what we are going to be implementing in our project. When a user sign up, automatically a private key, public address, and a wallet address is going to be added to the database of each user. Then the user will use it to access his funds, send and receive funds. So that's what I want to show you. Okay, so guys, what we're going to be doing next is applying user authentication. This is going to allow users to log in and sign up. I want to say something. We're not going to be coding everything bit by bit. We're going to be tapping into the source code to take some things and copy paste. Since I've already built this project before, all I need to do is just to head over to my project and then paste it. That's why I advise you guys to check out the source code on my GitHub so you don't get stuck on the way or anything. Now let's proceed. First of all, I'll tell you that we're going to be using Postgres SQL. We're not using MySQLite, the default SQL for Django. So to set up Postgres SQL, follow my lead. Now we're going to open our pgAdmin, and on databases, we're going to create a new database. And then once it fetches all the data we need, we're going to call it Bitcoin Wallet. And the owner is Postgres. Now we've saved that. We're going to connect our project to this new database we created. To do that, first of all, let me quit this. Now to do that, we're going to head over to our settings. And in our settings, we're going to look for database. So we're just going to clear all this, paste this in. Okay. Let's head over here. copy this, and we're going to paste this in. Now what this is the code to connect your project to the database. The engine we're using is PostgreSQL. The name of the database we created was Bitcoin Wallet. The user is Postgres. The password is this. And then the host is a local host. It's not online yet. So now I'm just going to save this. Now we've connected our project to this database, but we've not migrated anything. To migrate, I'm going to, let's create a new terminal. And then let's say Python 3 manage.py make migrations. It should say no changes. Yeah, no change detected. And now I'm going to say Python 3 manage.py migrate. Now all the user authentication and everything is migrated to that database. Now let's cross check here. To do that, we're going to head over to schemas. And then in tables, we see that all the data are now migrated. If we open this auth user, we can see view data all rows. Now we can see everybody in our database. Now this is what we did. We just created our database, connected it to our Django project, and then migrated all the modules. That's simple. So now let's go straight into having a user sign in and sign up. Now, as I told you, I'm going to be tapping some codes. I'm going to be getting some codes from the source code. Now, to do this, let's just head over to URLs. And in the URLs, I'm going to specify, I think, two more URLs. Okay, CVV. And that will be login and register. Let's just copy paste this here. Login and then login, and then should take it from views or register, and the name should be register. Now let's head over to views. Let's do the same for here. Now we're going to change this to login and also login.html, and that's because of this template right here. And we're going to change this to register and this to register.html. Now this should be good to go. When we save this now, if we go back to our project, let's say we head back over here and then refresh this. If we click on login, okay, this accounts, this login. Wow. What's going on is that we have another app in the front end that too. So I don't know how to explain this, but let's just go ahead to fix this right here. To do that, I think we're going to have to create another app. Okay, wallets, yes. We're going to have to create another app. If you check this here in the URLs, nothing here in the accounts. This is where everything mainly is. URLs.py. Login views and so on. So all we just need to do now is simple. Let's head over to this place and search for where we type login. It says account just login slash login, I mean. So we just need to remove this. Remove this. And remove this. Now when we go back and refresh, we don't need to refresh, we just need to go back and then press login. Go back. Refresh the page. Now press login. You see now it gives us a beautiful login page. Very beautiful. I love this. Now I click on register. See, it gives us register, a very beautiful register page. Now what I want to do now is, when a user fill in some information, because it just fills in a random information, is check the information, if it's a good information, and then once you click on register, it should register the user and save those information into this database. Now let's go ahead to do that. To do this, we're going to head over to our views file. And as I said, we're taking it from the source code. So all we just need to do is to look for register. I'm going to copy the old dev and just copy it like this and then paste it. Let me make this a little bit small so you guys can see. So we need to import some class, at least I think only one or two. What we need to import is all this. Let's just copy this and then paste it right here. Now we are good to go. Now when we save this and we head over here, everything will work. But before doing that, I have to explain all this code. Now what this does, once a user tries to register, it automatically creates a private key, it creates a public key, and it generates an address for the user. Then once the user clicks on register, it also gets the username, the email, the password, the private key, the public key, and the address. And it's going to check if the two passwords are equal. If you can see in this place, we told the user to repeat the password, to type the password twice. That's just for making sure that the user knows his or her password. And it's going to check if the passwords are the same. If the passwords are the same, it's going to check if that email already exists. If the email already exists, it's going to tell the user email taken. If not, it's check if the username already exists. If username already exists, it's going to say username taken. But if there is no problem, it's just going to say user equals user.object.create. Basically, what this code does is it just takes the user's data and then creates an account for the user. And then after that, it's going to send the user to the login page. In the login page, the user is going to be able to log in and access his wallet address and funds. Now let's also take care of the login page. To do that, we're going to head back to our code and then look for login and just copy that in this place. I'm going to paste it. Now this should take care of the login. What this does, once a user tries to log in, it's going to get a username with this variable, it's going to get a password, and then it's going to say user equals authentic auth.authenticate, username equals username, password equals password. What this does is that it takes these two fields, username and password, and it logs in the user into our site. But before it does that, it's going to check if the user is not known. What this condition means is that if the user is in our database, then log the user in. Else, say invalid credentials. Now that should do the work. Let's just save this. And then I think we can go and test it out. Now once we refresh this page, okay, it says refuse to connect. I'm sure that because let's just make this a little bit. When we head over to this place, it says from dot models import details. Now what we need to do is to go to our wallet app and then we need to paste some code here in this place, models.py. Let's just take this whole thing and then paste it here. What this does, this is the model, Django model we're going to use to save the balance, the amount of transactions, the total amount the user has sent bitcoins, received bitcoins, and so on. And it's also going to get the live bitcoin price and so on. Now this is just basically what this does. So it was missing that, that's why it gave us this error. Now when we save this, it doesn't give us any error. Now when we come here and refresh this page, let's try to create an account. Why not? Let's create an account, let's say admin. Let us say admin. sa@gmail.com. Let's username be A. The password be A. Now we can use this to check if the password are the same. Now let's register. Now it says value too long for the type of data. Now if you notice, let's go back. If you notice, let's open the inspect function. Let's make this a little big. In this place, we have just four fields, 1, 2, 3, 4. But if we head over to this inspect function, we're going to see that we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. We have 7 fields. And why is that? That's because this field, the first 3, takes the normal credentials, but the remaining takes the Bitcoin private key and wallet address. Now with same private key, as you can see, getting the value of that private key that we generated with Python code here, then it's sending it to the HTML so it can send it to the database. See, generate a public key here, this is the public key, and then after that generate a wallet address. Now if this sign up is successful, this is the wallet address that will be pushed to the database. But now it gave us an error when we tried, and the error was, okay, let's go back and do this again. It said data value too long for this. What this is trying to say is that in this PG admin, let's first try to see for 30. In this PG admin, in this first name, it says the highest characters you can take is 30. But if you come over to these views of UI, in the register function, you'll see that once it's creating an account, the first name is giving it an address. And sometimes a Bitcoin address can be more than 30 characters. So what we just need to do is to adjust that. And we can adjust that by clicking on columns, username, properties. Then it says 30. What we just need to do is to say like 90. That should be enough. Now once we save this, okay, when we refresh this now, you can see that that has fixed it. Now it's saying 90. Now when we come here and try to resubmit that same data, say continue, you see that it successfully created the user. Now when we come into PG admin, if we refresh this table by doing this all rows, we can see that it created a new user with the username A, with the Bitcoin wallet, the private key, the email. Now, don't be surprised, we save the private key as first name. We save the wallet address as first name and the private key as last name. That's just not to get any error. It also gets the date the user joined. Now, this has done the authentication. Let's try to log in. For now, you see it says last login, no. That means the user has not logged into the site at all. Now, if you try to log in by saying it's A, the password is A. Let's see. You see, it takes us back to this page. This is very good. You see that it takes us back to this page. Now, all we need to do is to set up the page to function. That means this side to show when the user is logged in, and this to show when the user is not logged in. Now to do that, I'm just going to head over to our index.htm, and all we have to do is head over to this index.htm, go to the templates, Ctrl AC, just gotta paste it, Ctrl A and B. And then we need to make some changes like login, not account slash, it is just this. Okay, so now let's go check it out. Now when we refresh this, as we all know, the user is now authenticated. Let's cross check here. When we refresh this table, it should show the last time the user was last logged in. Let's say view data all rows. Let's see. Now you see that it says last logged in 2029 on this date. Now when we head over here and refresh, you see that this down will be gone. You see, that other page is gone. Now it gets the user's wallet address. And then the user, I'm going to show you some other functionalities later. But as you guys can see, everything is working fine. But let's add one more thing, which is going to allow the user to log out. To do that, we're going to head over to our views. All we just need to do is to create df log out, a logout function. I think it's also going to take a request or not. Let's test it out. We'll say out dot logout. We're going to do something like this. Let's cross check. We're going to come to wallets. Nope, we're going to come to account views. And then at the bottom, this is what we need. Now this will cover up the logout. Once we save this, we need to go and specify it in the URLs. Let's just copy this. Let's just say logout. Then last thing, we are good to go. Now when we come here and refresh this page, once we log out, you see it redirects us to the home page. Now when a user comes to our site, this is what the user is gonna see until the user head over to login. Once the user login, it's login as A and A, and we click on login. Now we see our Bitcoin wallet and all. It also says hello A. This is everything I've done with the code before recording this video. So check out the code on my GitHub so you guys don't get stuck on the way. So what we need to do now is to create an admin interface in which we can maintain our site from. Let's do that. So now we have the sites going well. What I just want to do now is to apply our admin interface. In Django, Django has a built-in function. That's a built-in admin interface which allows you to maintain your site. That means you don't need to go to pgadmin or Postgres. Maybe your site is hosted online. You can just go to the site then slash admin. And then it will take you to log into this admin interface. But to be able to access this admin interface, you need to be authenticated as an admin. That means you need to be authenticated as a super user. So this is for protection of your site, meaning nobody with any account can just log into your site and access your database. So from your own command line, you need to create a super user. To do that, we're going to head over to our Visual Studio Code. And then in this terminal, let me make that big for the people on mobile. So right here, I'm going to say python 3 manage.py create super user. Now this is going to create an admin account. When we click on enter, it will ask us to type in our username. Let's just type in admin. email address, let's say admin@gmail.com, and a password, let's say admin again, and this is bypass it. Now you see that successfully created another user. Friends, before we log in, let's head over to our PG admin. You see, for now we have only one user, but when we refresh this table, it should show us two users. Now you see it says A, that's the first username, and the second username is admin. And if you head over to this place, it asks if this user is a staff. For this admin, it says true. If a user is a staff, that means the user is allowed to enter the admin page. Now let's just head over here and log in that account we created and click on enter. Now you see, this is the admin user interface. We can just click on users and then see the details of the database of our users. We don't need to head over to PG admin. This is very good because when your site is online, you might find it difficult to connect your database straight to PG admin. But with this, you can just go to your domain/admin and then access your database. And that's how to apply admin interface into your projects. So now that we have our admin interface up and running, what we need to do next is to get the wallet details. That means the details of a Bitcoin wallet address of our user. To do that, we are going to use web scraping. We are going to scrape blockchain.com. Blockchain.com. Now this site has the details of any Bitcoin wallet created. If I create a Bitcoin wallet now, whether with Python or with any app, it automatically added to this site database. Now when we search any Bitcoin wallet, we'll be able to see the details. Let's just test it out. Let's copy this and say search. Okay, I'll put this search here. I think I'm explore. So it's going to open the Blockchain Explorer for us to search. Just showing you the site in which we're going to be scraping from. Okay, I think my internet connection is a little buggy. So when we paste this now, as you see, we copy this wallet address from the user's address we just created. Now I want to check the balance. We can see we're checking it in USD. So when we click enter, it should tell us the price, the latest transaction or not. Okay, I think something is fine. Okay, now it's going to load it and then tell us the details of this wallet. These guys, pardon me. Don't click on BTC. As you can see in the bottom here, it's loading the wallet, getting details. Now you can see it gives us this wallet. It says no transaction done yet. And then in the total received, it says hasn't received any Bitcoin, hasn't sent any, and then the final balance is zero. Yes, that's very correct because we just created it for a user. Now we know this, but the user doesn't know what he has in his wallet. So we want to show that to the user. To do that, we're going to head over here. It's a pretty long code. So first let me decrease this so you guys can see the workflow. And then I'm going to head over to my source code and then copy this whole thing. I'm going to explain the whole code one by one. Then I'm heading over to this place, to my normal project. And then just click on enter. Yeah. So what this does is using web scraping to get the data of the wallet address, to get the wallet address details. If you see, it says address request.post. Get this is just getting the user's address. Then this is the site which we are going to use to get the current price of Bitcoin. And then this is just to parse the site. This is also to get the current price, as you can see. can see the live price of Bitcoin. And then this is now what we need to use to get the wallet details. To do that, we say soup equals bs4.btfsoupres.pap. Now this rest is taking a request, it's getting a request from this page. This page is the page, is this page. This page is this page. Now from this page, we want to get some details, which is this four. We want to get these four details. And that's simple. We just say the final balance equals balance 4.getText. What we just need to do is to right click on this and click on inspect. If you're familiar with web scraping, you understand what I'm saying. But if you don't know web scraping that much, you can check out my channel at Code with Tommy. I have a tutorial there on web scraping. Now you see this, where the final balance is located. It's located in a D class. Let's see where it's getting this from. Located in a span tag with the class of SC and all. If you can check it out here, it's located in a span tag with the class of all these. Now this is how web scraping works. We just get the text in between a tag having the correct information. That means we have the tag and we have what class that tag is representing. Now that's just all I need to explain. That's what is done throughout in the balance, getting the balance. We check it out here. We're getting the final balance, the transaction, the total received, the total sent, and the live Bitcoin price. And we also did something to get the balance in USD. Because as you can see, this just shows us the balance in Bitcoin. So we also got the live Bitcoin price. Then we did a little arithmetic. We multiplied the two and then we got it in USD. Now after getting all those, we just implemented all those data into this model in which we created this time. I think you guys should remember when we created this model that I said is going to be useful. Now we are going to get all the models and then pass all this data into it, and then we are going to take all this data and then send it to this index.htm page. Now this index.htm page is the page which is going to show the user everything he needs to know about his wallet. Now when we save this, let's make it big once again. So now all I just need to do is to head over here. First, let me log out as an admin. And now you see that when I log in, when I try to go to the index, I'm going to have to log in. Let's say A and A A. Now let's log in. Now you see, we have our wallet address. But what we need to, when we click on submit, that's what we need to do. Just need to click on submit. It's going to get the details of our wallet. Now you see now it gives us 0 BTC, 0 BTC, 0 time amount of transactions in USD, gives us 0. Now if you can notice, you see that this is equivalent to this. Exactly the same thing. We scraped the data and then added it into our site to show the user what he needs to know. Now that's how to get the wallet address details. I hope you guys understood that. If you didn't, please drop a comment. I will answer all questions. Now that the user can now see the details of his wallet address, he has everything he needs to know about his address. Let's allow the user to be able to access his QR code. Bitcoin address, each Bitcoin address has a specific QR code. That means when someone wants to send you funds into your Bitcoin address, it's not a must they have the address. If they have a picture of your QR code, they can also fund your wallet. Let me give you an example of a QR code. Let's say Bitcoin QR code. You click on images. Now this is exactly how a Bitcoin QR code looks like. Each of these QR code has a specific wallet assigned to it. If you pick up your Bitcoin wallet, whatever you are using, let's say blockchain, let's say bitcoin.com, If you scan this QR code, it's going to give you a wallet address. Now that's what we want to apply into our project. We want it that whenever a user scan that wallet, that QR code, it should bring out the user's wallet address. To do that, we're also going to use web scraping. But in the last section, we scraped data. We scraped only text data. But this time we're scraping an image, a QR code. To do that, we have a site which assigns QR code to every wallet address. This is the site, bitrev.com. If you have the specific link, let's say, just copy our wallet address and then paste it here. Now, this is a specific link to get the QR code of each wallet address. Now, this is the QR code of this wallet address which we created earlier. What we just need to do is to get the same link for every single user that signs up. In the front-end code, I've done that in the source code. I remember we copy-pasted everything. Now, if you head over to the index.html, in index.html, if you scroll to line 206, you'll see I have modified that already to make things easier for you guys. In the https bitrev.com, I had modified it to make sure it gets the QR code for each specific user. But if you don't understand what I did yet, basically what I did, I just put an image tag, but the source of the image is this link for each user. So what this means that is getting the QR code for each wallet address assigned to a user. Now let's head over to our wallet address and check. Now if we click on receive Bitcoin, we see our QR code there. That's what I did. Now in the next section, I'm going to be talking about sending and receiving Bitcoin. That is the most crucial section, and that is the final section of this tutorial. So now that a user can successfully see his QR code and send the image to his friend or anybody to fund his wallet with his QR code, let's be able to send and receive Bitcoin. To do this, it's very simple. We're just going to apply a little bit of JavaScript. It's JavaScript that allows us to click on this receive Bitcoin, and then the QR code will come up, and then this address will come up. But I'm not going to click on send Bitcoin for now, for a specific reason. Now, for a user to receive Bitcoin, it's very easy. In the front-end code, I modified it. If you take it from the source code, you will see that this is already the built-in. What I did was that once a user click on copy address, what the user's address is going to be copied to the clipboard so he can send it to whoever wants to fund his wallet. And for the user to receive Bitcoin through QR code, all you need to do is to scan this QR code below, and then the user is going to be able to have his wallet funded. Now let me go to the code to explain that. Now above this QR code, you can see we have a little bit of JavaScript. It's a button on click. Now this button is this button here. By saying on the on click, it should set out my function. So if we search for this, you see that it automatically copies the text. And which text is it copying? It's copying the text with the my input ID. If we come over here and then inspect, we'll see that the ID of this input tag is my input. See it right here, my input. Now that is the text it's getting. So what we're trying to say is on click, once a user click on this copy address button, it's going to copy this wallet address, that's his wallet address, to the clipboard. That's what the JavaScript does, basically. And now for the send function. Once the user click on send Bitcoin, it says this feature is coming soon. For now, you can have access to your funds by exporting it into another wallet provider that has the functionality to send Bitcoin. To do that, click the button below to get your wallet private key, and you can export it to another wallet provider. Now, click on this thing, you'll see that you can have your private key. Now, for now, now I figured out a way to send Bitcoin using Python, but I figured out another way to access your funds, because it wouldn't make sense if you can only receive funds but you can't spend your funds. So for you to be able to spend your funds in this wallet, you're going to have your private key, and then from your private key you can import it, you can import your wallet into blockchain or Bitcoin or any other wallet and then access your funds. But this wallet is very good because it has QR code scan. You can easily access your funds, you can easily receive Bitcoin, and that's all for this. But in future videos, I'm going to make sure I do a video on how to send Bitcoin specifically with Python or JavaScript or any programming language you guys have. And that's going to be all for this tutorial series. I hope you guys enjoy it. I hope you have a Bitcoin wallet now that you built by yourself and you can add to your portfolio. If you did, please don't forget to smash the like button and please subscribe. I really appreciate that. And turn on post notification so you be the first to get notified when I drop new videos like this. And if you have any questions, please drop it in the comments or message me on Twitter. I'll be sure to answer all questions. Thank you for watching. Bye for now. So guys, before we go, I want to show you guys an overview of everything we built. Basically what we did is, let's log out first. When a user comes to this site, this is what the user will see. A plain home page of a site, and then the user can register, and after registration the user will be redirected to the login page. After the user is logged in, let's log in with one, the user will have his wallet address right here. You'll see it broad and clear white. Now when the user clicks on submit, the user is going to get details of his wallet address. Sees no transactions, no Bitcoin. And that's basically all we did. And we also added a feature which gives the QR code, so someone can find this wallet with this QR code or just copy this address. And then in the send Bitcoin, we add a private key so the user can access his private key. And that's all we did in this video. I hope you guys enjoyed this video. If you did, once again, please subscribe. Thank you so much for watching. I really appreciate it. If you watched to this end, I really appreciate it. Thank you so much.